you the business tips to successfully start and run your business so your business doesn't run you. And more importantly, we provide personal development tools to create a better version of yourself to provide the solid foundation for your life and business to stand upon. This is The Biz Reveal, and I'm your host, Craig Sawyer. This week's episode is sponsored by Sawyer Health Solutions. Protecting what's important to you is what's important to us. Get your free health insurance quote at SawyerHealthSolutions.com. Using examples of how some underdogs in the sports world become extraordinary leaders by preparing with passion, Jim Roddy explains how ordinary people will accomplish extraordinary feats when their energy is properly channeled. Jim shares anecdotes and the five key principles from his book, The Walk-On Method to Career and Business Success, so you too can meet a few of the inspiring people he met on his publishing journey. After the show, you can find Jim on LinkedIn or look for his book on Amazon. This is the Biz Reveal Podcast with this week's guest, Jim Roddy.
I'm Jim Roddy, author of The Walk-On Method to Career and Business Success. Published a book in 2020. It was the second book I published. The first one was on hiring best practices called Hire Like You Just Beat Cancer. I am a proud 19-year cancer survivor, but I don't take credit for that. It's the doctors, the nurses, and everybody else who took care of me. I did not perform my own colectomy or the chemotherapy. I just sat in a chair and everybody else.
That would have been a story, though.
It would be. You'd probably, I'd be a little more famous and have a different book if I was able to perform my own surgery. And then my background, I've spent most of my career in the IT industry and a lot of it in the publishing aspect of it. So when I was 23, I launched my own sports magazine. I'm in Northwest Pennsylvania, Erie, Pennsylvania. And then down the hallway was actually a technology publisher. So after doing my own sports magazine for 5.5 years, the technology publisher recruited me away. I was there for a little bit over 17 years, the last 11 as president of the company. And then I ended up the last few years, I've been a business coach, counseling small to medium sized business owners, mostly technology solution providers in the retail, restaurant, and grocery verticals. And then I right now specifically serve members of the Retail Solutions Providers Association, an association that's a collection of those business leaders, business owners, business managers in the IT sector.
Well, so you've been around a little bit.
I have been, yes. There's it keeps me out of trouble, no doubt about it. But, you know, and tying in with the walk-on method, I, you know, learned, you know, try things, test things, do what you can to try to have an impact on people, and don't sit still, right? Go after things.
Yeah, and I like that you've been in different industries as well. It's not just one industry, so you should have some knowledge that relates kind of across the board, you know, like you said, in you know, retail, restaurant, and then you've got, you know, the IT and things like that. So that's cool. So it should be fairly universal what we're talking about. Obviously, anytime we're talking about steps in, you know, being successful in business and things like that, there's going to be some specifics that are industry specific, but at least we can talk about some generalizations and some general steps that you should take to be able to be successful in whatever it is that you do.
Yeah, and the fundamentals are true across no matter what business. So, like I said, the 17 years that I spent, the company was called Jamison Publishing, but we were part of a larger organization that was owned by two brothers, Rick and Terry Peterson. And so they had a print business, they had a web business, they now started a cartridge company, like for ammunition. They also had, you know, other in technology sectors and real estate and security. So it ran the gamut. But we had specific principles that we followed that were like 4 or 5 pages long that applied to every single business. And then each, you know, organization had kind of like a 1-page addendum that was some industry specific things. But, you know, there are some real fundamentals from a business standpoint of, are you going after a burgeoning market? Are you going after something that actually isn't growing? Do you have a formula to increase sales or don't you, right? Are you trying to control your costs, or are you just letting those things go out of control? Are you focused on building an appropriate culture? Or are you just hiring whoever shows up and can fog a mirror? So a lot of those principles applied, and it was really kind of surprising to me, no matter what industry you're in, no matter what size of company, a lot of those business fundamentals really apply through and through.
And probably a lot of them were not paid attention to the way they should have been too. And sometimes you just need that guideline to just walk you through it to make sure you don't overlook anything. One of the things I noticed about your profile before we got on the show, when I was preparing for the conversation together, is that you believe in servant leadership. And that's one of the things that I believe in very strongly as well. Explain to everybody what servant leadership is to you and what it means.
Good question. I guess I was a fan of servant leadership before I knew that actually what servant leadership was. And right. So my example is, I'll take you all the way back to high school. You're probably thinking, great, just what I wanted to
only bring 4 or 5 years ago, right?
Well, no, I'm 51. This is in the 1980s. But I went to a really small Christian school, Bethel Christian School here in Erie, Pennsylvania. And when I say small, I tell people I graduated third in my class, but I was not in the top 10%. We graduated 15 kids, and that was the largest class in the history of our school. But one thing that we did was, like, every senior class would go on a trip and they do their own fundraising for it. And they would tend to go to New York City or Washington, D.C. or something like that. And somehow, I can't remember whose idea it was, but it was, how about we go on a mission trip to Jamaica? Right. And so we could actually, like, the whole crew go, right, the entire senior class, get some chaperones, go to Jamaica, do some mission work, be able to just go to Jamaica. And so 18 years old, and this, you know, we're like, great, let's go do it. Well, my parents said that was too dangerous. We don't want you to go. And then there's another girl in the class whose parents didn't want her to go. So our class took a vote with no parents in the room, no teachers in the room, and said, do we still want to do this? And even though I was class president and I wasn't going to go, I remember getting up at that podium and saying, like, I am 100% supporting going, you guys going to Jamaica. Like, I would regret it the rest of my life if I voted against you guys doing that. And then I remember at graduation, they actually gave me a plaque, and it was honoring me for my servant leadership. And I was hoping my parents would come up on stage and go, we've changed our mind, you can go. And it'd be like some storybook, you know, magical ending to it. But it was not to be. I still didn't go. But that plaque to me is more important than, I guess, any sand I would have had between my toes. So that was a lesson early on. And it kind of really blends in with the book, you know, the walk-on method, where if you, like, sincerely put team goals first and put your selfish aspirations aside, to me, that is far more rewarding than some plaque or trophy or something that you could get, or some accolades or even money, right? Or anything of that nature. So to me, servant leadership is genuinely finding out what your teammate needs, what your organization needs, and making sure those things are taken care of. It doesn't mean that you get beaten and getting used or anything like that, but it's truly focusing on them first and how can you help them achieve their goals, and everything you have is secondary. And again, the walk-ons, you know, these are non-scholarship athletes on a scholarship team. The vast majority of them weren't getting much, if any, playing time, but they could have sat on the bench and moped, or they could have just not played, but they were like, how can I help these other teammates? How can I help them in practice? How can I help them during the game? How can I lead an enthusiasm? So that is, you know, again, I've had very early lessons in servant leadership, and happy to learn more as I can about servant leadership as life goes on.
Yeah. And to me, the servant leadership is all about inspiration, you know, being able to inspire others to succeed, because not everybody's self-motivated, right? And I think your job is to find out what motivates each person that's on the team. When I was in the Marine Corps, that was like one of the number one rules of leadership when you're, you know, studying and, you know, you're trying to get promoted up into the NCO ranks and things like that, is know your Marines. And it's the same thing in business. You got to know your people and what motivates them. And my short story, I won't make this a long one because this is about you, not me, but just to relate to what you were discussing, is when I was in boot camp, my knees were shot. My knees were gone. In fact, my nickname from the drill instructors was Penguin because of the way I wobbled around all the time. But I made it through everything, as painful as it was, but it inspired some of the other Marines that were around me, the other recruits, like, my God, this guy's just, you know, pounding through it. You know, we're having a hard time, but he's half handicapped right now because his knees are shot, but he's just pushing through. And one of the biggest honors I've had in my life was when I got done. One of the other recruits in my platoon gave me his Eagle Globe and Anchor that we got at the top of the hill. You know, when they say, hey, you know, you guys are Marines, he gave me his in appreciation of the inspiration that he gave him. And I still have that put away in a little box. And that is one of the most momentous things that I've ever gotten, just because of what it meant, what I meant to them and the inspiration. So to me, that's servant leadership as well. And I think that the leader should be working, you know, twice as hard as people that they are leading, You know, to show them, hey, man, let's do this. It shows them that you're all part of it.
Can I just say first, thank you for your service.
Oh,
but that's a fabulous story. And my guess is your intent was, I'm going to inspire these guys. Like, that's why I'm doing it. Like, servant leadership is, you're just doing the right thing, working on, you know, behalf of other people. And oftentimes people will notice. And if you're giving a word of encouragement, you might not know what that person is going through. So always be looking out for somebody else and what you can do for them. And who knows when it's going to really pay off for them in a big way.
Yeah, and it inspires them to do the same for others, and it kind of just spreads. And
correct.
It's amazing to sit back and watch. And at the time, you know, I was young, just like you, you know, at the time. And sometimes you're not even thinking about that part of it. I wasn't. I was like, no, this is something I set out to do, and I need to do it it was kind of personal, because I was like, no, I can't fail. I can't go back home and say I failed. So I kept pushing. But in turn, because of that determination, it did inspire some others. And that just makes me feel really good. And
That was
20 something years ago, and I still carry that with me. And it still kind of, if you couldn't tell when I'm talking here, still kind of gets to me a little bit. So it means a lot. Now, you wrote this book, Walk On Method. And it's kind of using sports analogies and sports figures as examples of, I guess, the fundamentals of business. And that's what we're going to be discussing today. What inspired you to write this book?
Good question. And sometimes people think, well, it's a sports book, but it really, sports just happened to be the vehicle that a lot of these folks learned traits, or had some of these traits that they might have had strengthened and chiseled, that they then applied to their career, and sometimes even second nature. So what motivated me to write the book, a handful of things. What really sparked it was when my first book came out. I told you about, you know, Hire Like You Just Beat Cancer. It was the first time that a lot of people in the industry that I worked in learned that I had cancer, because it's kind of not the thing that you weave into a conference call, right? Sure. How's your day? Did you know 15 years ago I had cancer? And so once that book came out, I had somebody say to me, and I distinctly remember this, at a conference, and they said, now I know why you behave the way that you do. Now I know why you're so determined. And I was like, I appreciate that. But I walked away like, I don't think about myself every day as like, I overcame cancer, I got to fight it. Just kind of like I framed it up for you. Like, I just sat in a chair, sat at an operating table. Everybody else did the work. Like, I just kind of was along for the ride, you know, like riding a roller coaster, though not as much fun, obviously, as a roller coaster by any means. And so I started thinking to myself, like, what really does drive me? What has really shaped me? And then I started realizing that I attack cancer the same way that I attacked my goal to be a walk-on at Gannon University, a Division II small college basketball powerhouse here in Erie, Pennsylvania. And so then I looked at why did I start my own sports magazine when I was 23, like with $6,000 in my bank account? Well, it's because there was another goal that I wanted to get, and I really went after it. And then, so I started writing down on a sheet of paper, like, okay, what is the formula that has actually worked out for me over the years? Because I haven't gotten by on my looks, or, you know, it's not like I had a Harvard degree or Yale degree or something like that I could just, you know, show my paper and find success. And so I started jotting down on paper, like, what is the formula? And I came up with, like, wow, this is the walk-on method. And so I wanted to tell everybody, but I didn't think anybody wanted to hear just like my personal stories about being a bench warmer at Gannon, my own, you know, just what one person did. You know, no one's going to say, please, Jim, go on about that game versus Queens College. Please tell me more. And so I knew my story alone wouldn't motivate as many people. But I thought, what if I interviewed 5 former walk-ons and found out, did they follow a similar path as me? And they did. And then I talked to 10, and then I talked to 20, and then I talked to 30, and realized, you know, that the theory that I had about the walk-ons and everything that they went through, and the walk-on method in general, didn't just help them as college athletes. It really was key to them becoming a broadcaster or a doctor or an insurance broker or an engineer or a business owner or a filmmaker or a minister. So the mindset, the skills, and the behaviors that they developed were incredible. And so here's kind of the gist of the book. So ordinary people will accomplish extraordinary feats when their energy is properly channeled. And I see all of us are ordinary in many ways. And so the way that these walk-ons behave now in the business world is second nature, because they were forced to behave that way to survive as a walk-on. So that's what the book really does, is connects what actions did they take, what actions can you take in order to experience career and business success. Because there's no secret, like, this is the formula. These are the fundamentals that we talked about earlier that apply across every person in every kind of workplace.
So if you master these five steps that we're going to talk about, you're pretty much on a great path. Now, nothing guarantees success, of course, but this is going to be as close to, hey, this is a good foundation for you. Once you get these things going, you've got a great chance, or at least you've multiplied your chance of being successful.
100%. Like, if your goal is I'm going to jump from here to the moon, like, obviously that's impossible. You're not going to be able to do it no matter how much you apply the formula. But, you know, oftentimes when you see somebody who's successful, you know, they're presented on the cover of a magazine or on a YouTube video or something like that as a genius, right? Or as just some lightning striker. They're just have this magical thing about them. But the folks that I talked to for this book and what I've experienced over the years, because I've had the opportunity to work with a lot of business owners, a lot of business leaders, when you really dig into what made them successful, it's oftentimes these traits that we're going to be talking about that really make up the walk-on method. Like you said, no guarantee to success, but I do guarantee you, if you skip over these steps or if you don't follow through them, your chances of success are going to be slim. You're going to be hoping that you hit the lottery, is essentially what it is.
Well, let's get into it then. Step one in the walk-in method is take a big shot. So who inspired that first step of the walk-on method, and explain what that means, take a big shot?
Yeah, so there's a part of every walk-on that we interviewed had some of these steps to a degree. So it wasn't like just one person that that inspired that step, but we say, take a big shot. Anybody can make a layup. So don't sell yourself short when you're setting your next career goal or your business goal. Don't contemplate what you really want and then aim for something less just to play it safe, because anybody can do that. And so a great example of that that we have in the book is Yogi Roth. So he went to Lackawanna Trail High School in tiny Dalton, Pennsylvania, which I'm guessing most people listening to this right
I'm
now
just have impressed never even that you heard. Can pronounce it.
Lackawanna. Well, I'm a Pennsylvania guy, so all right. You know, we know the Lackawanna Trail. So it's outside of Scranton, and so he committed when he was in ninth grade to say, "I'm going to play major college football." Even though he wasn't that good at football, he just loved the game. But he said, what do I need to do to get there? Went to summer camps, even went to Notre Dame for a summer camp. He was only 5'11", and he had coaches tell him, like, you got to be realistic about your ability. And his attitude was, I don't care what you say, I'm just going to try even more. And so he went to a football game at University of Pittsburgh, Pitt beat Notre Dame, and he says to his dad, not only am I going to play major college football, I'm going to play at Pitt. Right. And so, again, he goes to this really tiny school. Well, he does end up getting the chance to walk on at Pitt. He shows up in the locker room. He says, where's my locker? The equipment manager says, who are you? And he thought, well, I can't believe you wouldn't know my name. Like, I'm on the team. And he said, well, you're in locker 106. And he's like, well, that's not good. Like, to be in 106, because how many guys are there on the team? It's in a separate room. His cleats are too big. His helmet was too big. And he said, I wouldn't want it any other way. I'm going to define my life as a competitor. And so he pushed to get some playing time there. And then afterwards, he took that same attitude in order to say, what can I do that's big? He actually got offered a coaching job at Akron, and he said, I want something bigger. And he decided to get into TV, got to do TV games at Pitt. But he said, I need something bigger than this. He decided to go to LA. So he moves out to LA, not with anything that was locked in, ends up hooking up with Pete Carroll, who coached at USC at that time, is the assistant quarterbacks coach. He gets offered a quarterback coaching job at the University of Washington. He turns it down because he says, I came out here to take a bigger swing at the media. So long story short, after working his way up, he now is in the Pac-12 network as a host. He's done work on Fox, ESPN, Turner, Sirius XM. He's direct produced and starred in a bunch of films. He has multiple podcasts. He's an author. But he says, if your dream doesn't make you feel a little uncomfortable, it's not big enough. And so he said, I needed to play on Thursday night on ESPN, right? Like, I could have gone to any Division III school or Division II school and played football there. I needed to take that big shot. So again, you saw with that mindset that he had, even as a ninth grader, and he's carried that all the way through, and he continues to be successful, and he's, you know, lead college football analyst for the Pac-12 network.
That's awesome. Yeah, and it just multiplied and snowballed into multiple things. So dreaming big and doing big. And you made a good point about, you know, your dream's not big enough if it's not, doesn't make you uncomfortable. I believe the same thing, and I like making other people uncomfortable. You know, if other people think that I'm just nuts because of the dreams that I have, then I'm on the right path, right? I want to make them uncomfortable and make them think I'm crazy, because then that's something big. So,
but we have to pause, because too oftentimes we just follow what life gives us. And then you look back mm-hmm. and you're like, well, I wish I could have done more. And I think everybody's heard, you know, when they interview folks who are in their 80s or 90s and they ask them for their regrets, it's never anything that they did. It's typically something that they didn't do. So that's the whole thing, is pause and say, what is the big shot that I really want to take? But again, it's got to be commercially acceptable. It can't be jumping to the moon. But really try something big, something that you really want to do, something that could really help out other people.
So when you have a business, and we're going to relate this to, and because that feels to me like it's a little more personal, you know, goal setting and things like that. But obviously, we're talking about your goals as a business and what direction you want to take the business in. Do you have any examples of what that would be in the business sense that you may have personal experience with, as far as, you know, a big goal that a business had that might have seemed a little outrageous when they said it, but then, you know, once they got there, everybody's like, oh, aha.
Sure. Well, one that I share in the book is my own personal story. So when I was at Jameson, I was moving into the president, general manager role, a big association that I now actually work with, I mentioned earlier, the Retail Solutions Providers Association, we didn't have, as a magazine, much traction with that group. There was another magazine that was actually kicking our butt all over the place. And it's because there was, I won't get into all the details, but there were some bridges that were burned. Okay. I guess I'll just say that, with some former employees. And so when we started getting and being part of that association, the first trade show that we go to, everybody's talking about the other magazine. They're displaying awards from the other magazine in their booths. And we said, we've got to move past that magazine, right? Like, we've got to win the popularity contest among this constituency. And the question was, well, how do you go and do that? And so I remember, and just like we talked about earlier with servant leadership, we said, well, let's find out what the association needs and what the members need and just throw ourselves in there, right? There are things that we can do as a media property or just as people in order to lend our labor and lend our time. And so we did that, and ended up people started knowing who we were. And those who disliked us actually said they seemed to be okay people. And then when the awards program started happening, we didn't realize we were nominated for award in our category, and we won the silver award. And we were like, oh, wow, this is fantastic. Like, yeah, how about that? And then the next year we got gold. And the next year we got gold. And the year after that we got gold again. And then they had an award that was called the Gold Medallion Award. And it was the top overall vendor. And so after, it was about 5 or 6 years of us being part of that, we got the Gold Medallion Award. And it was like stunning, because we knew where we had come from. But we didn't set the goal to be like, well, let's be second to those people, or let's not be hated, or let's be okay. Ours was like, we really want to dominate. We really want to be known as the go-to source in this industry. And we ended up getting that. But again, it was, the root was, first we set that goal, and then we said, how can we help? How can we help? How can we help? And we certainly earned that, but it was something that we wanted to do for the good, obviously, of our organization, but also of the association to do that. But again, it started off with us saying, we're going to take this big shot, instead of saying, well, let's find another industry that might be easier.
Right. Yeah. Set the bar high, right? Because I always say, reach for the stars. You're at least going to get halfway there. You know, but if you don't set the bar high, then what really are you doing? All right, and that actually leads us to step two, which is make a passion statement. So kind of go through that step, because I think we're kind of leading to it as far as, you know, setting that big goal. So what's make a passion statement?
That's right. And it's passion with a P, not fashion with an F. And the elements of it are not just to play with passion, because that's what I think a lot of times where people see a walk on and they're like, there's just a hard worker and they're diving all over the floor doing all these things. But first, and this is what we found with the walk-ons, they prepare with passion, they practice with passion, and then they play with passion. And so back to that dream part, too many people just want to wish that their dream would come true, or they say, if that moment presents itself, like, that's when I'm going to give my all. But, you know, the walk-on method says, don't wish or wait, walk on to your dream. So do all those elements about playing, preparing, and practicing first with passion.
When you're self-employed, whether as an independent contractor or a business owner, when it comes to health insurance, you're on your own. Health insurance for the self-employed individual is imperative. When you get sick or injured, you aren't working and you don't get sick days. You may end up facing staggering medical expenses and loss of income. Health risks and uncertainties are a part of life. You can't always plan when you get sick, but you can be prepared for the financial aspect. The best way to be prepared against uncertain health risks is with the right health insurance plan. Call Sawyer Health Solutions today for your free consultation and quote. Allow us to put a plan together that makes sense for your situation. Call 239-677-9877 or go to our website at SawyerHealthSolutions.com. Protecting what's important to you is what's important to us.
And so a great example of this, and this is somebody who ended up launching their own business, you know, that's kind of to give the spoiler alert. And he's an untraditional walk-on, I would say, because a lot of times people think these walk-ons are like just driven from birth and super hardworking. But Dave Martin, so he attended Cal State Chico, and he said the only reason he attended there, it had a party school reputation. And he said he showed up in school because he didn't have a place to live anymore. And he said he was just kind of floating, but he had run in high school and he was looking for something to do. And he's walking by the track and he sees him running and he's like, maybe I'll do that. So he literally walks onto the track and walks up to the coach and says, can I run on the track team? And the coach says, yeah, I guess you can try. Now, the coach is a guy named Larry Burleson, former Green Bay Packer coach under Vince Lombardi. And so he was one of those tough old coaches, even though he wasn't that old, right? That's what Dave Martin said. You know, he was old, he acted old, but he actually wasn't that old. But he said he realized, I have not been putting in the work, right? I've been okay as a runner, but I haven't been sacrificing. I haven't been training. I haven't been sleeping. I wasn't putting forth enough effort. And so long story short, from an athletic standpoint, he became a three-time Division II All-American decathlete, school record holder, inducted into the Cal State Chico Athletics Hall of Fame. But he didn't stop there and like, I'm a great athlete. But he said, okay, how can I apply this to school? He was an exercise science major. And he said, I can do even better than that. And he decided to pursue his career as a physician. He said, I didn't even think of myself a doctor material, but my process was I am going to outwork people. I'm going to stay up longer, right? I'm going to study longer. I'm going to overcome somebody else's talent and somebody else's genius, somebody else's skill by outworking them. And so he has become a doctor. He's now Dr. Dave Martin. But then as from a business owner standpoint, he started his own medical center for advanced gynecology and women's wellness in Tennessee called Embrace. He's also an assistant professor at East Tennessee State. And so he's even a pioneer in his field for things that I wrote in the book about, but I don't even know exactly what they are, like bioidentical hormone, something or other. But again, this is somebody who was just floating, but he said, how can I really focus my energies? And he did that as an athlete. He did it as a student. He did it as a physician. He did it as a business owner. And he's super successful today because he keeps applying the same philosophy, the same formula to life, to work, to business ownership.
Practice how you play and play how you practice, right?
100%. Yep. It's not a light switch kind of thing. You've got to be there from the get-go.
Yeah. And I think passion is one of the things that's missing in a lot of areas in life in general, but especially in business, because a lot of people are in business for the wrong reasons, or maybe in their position for the wrong reasons. You know, hey, I want to take this job because this is the position that makes the most money. It's got the best salary. Or I want to work for this company because they have better benefits than the other company. And the passion is gone. And sometimes you can kind of see that over the years as well, right? Like back in the 50s, 60s, people stayed with companies for a lifetime. It was a career for life in most cases. And now I think it's something like 5 to 7 years. So the loyalty has kind of dwindled, but sometimes it's not just the loyalty to that specific company. It's like, you know, hey, opportunity is stagnant. You know, there's other factors in that as well. But I think one of the biggest things that is missing in general is passion. And I wish more people would get that back and dig deeper to find out what it is that's truly making them happy, not just the paycheck.
Yeah. So 2 points that I'll add to that. First, just a little family history to talk about loyalty. And this is something that I can say will never, ever happen again. Like usually you think, well, this will happen again. What I'm going to share with you will never, ever happen again. So my grandfather was one of 9 boys in the Zemecki family, Zymecki. Great Polish family. They had great Polish names like Florian, Chester, Sylvester, Wietold. All right. From age 16, right? This was back once you turned 16, you dropped out of school and went to work. All 9 Zemecki brothers dropped out of school at 16, went to work at the Hammermill paper plant, which was on the east side of Erie. From age 16, they all retired. from Hammer Roll Paper Plant. All nine of them all work there for whatever it would be, what, 50, you know, years or something like that, you know, 40 something years. Like, that will never happen again. So that is just like a totally different time from what we are right now. But then to your point about passion, I told you I coach a lot of business owners. Oftentimes, you know, when you talk to an entrepreneur, they're fast moving. They're trying this. They're not complaining. They just see an obstacle. They're trying to overcome it. They're trying to figure it out. Well, you talk to somebody who's maybe 10 years in, 15 years in, 20 years in or more, and they start saying like, well, this is hard. This is difficult. I wish things were different. I wish things were the way they were. And sometimes I have to say to them, like, did you have the same approach when you were starting the business? Did you have the same attitude, or did you have a different kind of hunger? And so that's why I think a lot of business owners have to get in touch with their entrepreneurial roots, their entrepreneurial side, and make sure they're still doing things from a passion standpoint and not just looking for oftentimes a path of least resistance or something that's comfortable, right? So stay uncomfortable. Make sure you're always attacking things with passion.
Yeah, we used to always say, get comfortable being uncomfortable. You know, once you get there, it gets easier. It should never be easy, right? Because again, we were talking about setting that bar high, making sure that, you know, the goal should be something that's difficult to achieve, but still achievable, but you should really have to work hard at it. But get comfortable being uncomfortable. And that's the key to a lot of things as well. All right. Step three, run uphill and embrace obstacles.
Yeah. And this ties in with what we just talked about in terms of, you know, when you're having difficult things, you have choices. And so oftentimes we're taught when there's an obstacle that we should seek the path of least resistance, right? If there's something bad happening, you shrink, you close your eyes, you get apprehensive. So where run uphill comes from was, this is going back to even my pre-high school days. So I ran a lot of road races. I was a cross-country runner. And so one thing that I noticed is whenever there was a hill, people would slow down and kind of trudge up the hill. And I don't know why I thought about this, but I thought, what if I charged up the hill? What if I sprinted up the hill? So I don't know if you've ever run road races before, but passing people is one thing. Passing people going up a hill, not only do you get in front of them, they'll look at you like you're crazy. Like, this guy's a psycho. Like, he has some advantage over me that I don't. And so what I've learned is talking to all these walk-ons, they don't avoid obstacles. They lean into the difficulty of their situation and actually embrace the obstacles because they know on the other end of the experience, they're going to be battle tested. So when you encounter a business challenge and you see other people around you wishing that the moment will pass, show courage, jump headlong into the problem, convert it into an opportunity or a victory. And we really saw that with this pandemic where, you know, I talk with a lot of folks who are like, I'm just going to bat down the hatches and hope that this goes away. Or, you know, you talk to people and they're like blaming the governor this, the governor that, I wish the governor whatever. But I saw a lot of people say, well, what can I do to enable my customers to have online ordering or curbside pickup, or what things can I do in order to help my customer do things better that's going to end up benefiting my business. So again, there's going to be a next recession, right? It might not be caused by a pandemic, but there will be a next recession. And what are you going to do when that shows up? And so the walk-on example that I have ties in with the recession. So Chris Doering was a three-sport high school star in Gainesville, Florida. He had all sorts of awards, long list of college options to choose from, but none of them was from his hometown hero team, the University of Florida. So he decided to walk on at Florida. Now, this is the early 90s. Steve Spurrier was just getting All-American talent there. So as a walk-on, he's getting like no reps, but he's putting the extra work. He worked his way up the depth chart and ended up earning a scholarship his junior year. He said when it was offered to him, he felt like he needed to run upstairs and sign it before they took it away and realized what they were doing. Well, he went from walk-on to scholarship player to a starter to actually playing in the NFL for 10 years. But that's not where his professional career ends. And that's not where he stops in terms of embracing obstacles. So he took that big shot and again, went through difficult obstacles at the University of Florida. He decided after the NFL to get into the mortgage industry just in time for the Great Recession of 2008. So we're talking about running up a hill. Like, he was scaling a mountain in bare feet, right? Yeah. Entering the mortgage industry in the middle of a recession. But instead of bailing, he took that same attitude that he had as a walk-on at Florida and said, I'm going to fight through this. I'm going to figure it out. So he fought through the financial crisis, established his own business. And he said, I had to block out the distractions on the periphery and really focus on what did I want to do? Like, what did I want to make out of this business? And part of the reason he wanted the business was to be able to have some freedom, right? right? And build it up and have other people work for him. And he's done that. He's now delegated his company, and that's enabled him to now have a sideline career in television broadcasting. He got a ton of rejections early on, but he now works today as a TV analyst for the SEC network. And it was funny. I just got to see him this fall on ESPN calling a University of Florida Gators game, right? So this guy has gone from they didn't even want him to being a successful business owner and then doing what he wants to do on the side in terms of as a broadcaster. So again, when you see a hill, when you see an obstacle, don't slow down to a walk, and sure as heck, don't stop. Run up that hill. Don't look for a shortcut to reduce the immediate pain, because you're going to miss the long-term benefits of gaining strength as you fight your way up that hill.
I love that analogy you had, though, about running. You know, because you're right. When you're going uphill, everybody knows when you're walking uphill, man, that's tough. That's when it hurts. That's when it burns. But that's when everybody is slowing down. So your best opportunity to get ahead is to take advantage of when everybody else is slowing down. No matter how hard it might be and how much it burns, you do that. And that's a great opportunity to take. So I love that analogy. All right. So who inspired step four? We've got for step four, it's no fuss, no muss. And when it says must, it's capital M-U-S. So I'm guessing that's an acronym. So walk us through that if you would.
Yeah. So it's no fuss, all must. So no fuss is means control your emotions, especially the negative ones, right? Like as a business owner, you're going to get a lot of rejections. You're going to have a lot of sales that you want to make and they don't come through. You're going to have an employee that doesn't work out, things of that nature. So you've got to control your emotions, right? Like take a moment, shake your head, but then get back to work and figure out what can I do better from this standpoint. So that's what the no fuss is about, controlling your emotions. All must stands for maximize unique strengths. So most of the walk-ons that we profile in the book, they were shorter, skinnier, and or slower than their more gifted scholarship teammates. But they figured out, what is my special ability that I have? What is my special attitude to bring to the team? And how can I maximize that for the whole? Like personally for myself, and I didn't realize this until much later looking back on it, but I went to walk on to the team at Gannon University. They didn't have formal tryouts. You just got to show up at preseason workouts, see if you can get on the floor, which I almost never did, for pickup games, and then show up and practice started October 15th. Everybody else in their practice gear, me and, you know, whatever I could bring with me. And so I would just, it was practice, and they said, at some point, we're going to tell you, you can keep coming back or get the heck out of here. Right. So the coach had, I went up to his office because I always wanted to check on the practice plan. And the head coach is there. He called me in and said, you know, hey, we're going to keep you on the team. And I have no idea what he said after that because my head was just spinning. But I realized he made that determination the day after midterm grades came out. And so I was a pretty good student. And I'm sure what he did was, and I've actually communicated with him afterwards, and he did not deny it. He probably said, okay, we've got 11 guys on the team. Jim will be the 12th. Let me factor in his grade point average. That actually raises the team GPA by 0.16. That helps me. I might as well do it. So I had the grades. That was my unique strength. And then also I was fast and I tried my best. And so if guys wanted to loaf, the coaches knew I wasn't going to, right? And so I was kind of the barometer. If everybody was finishing way behind me, they knew everybody else was loafing. So that was kind of my unique strength. It had nothing to do with directly winning games, but it was impacting what the coaches needed and what they were hoping for. And tying in with that, a great example, and this ties in with business ownership, is Brandon Landry. And so it's really easy to tie his walk-on experience to his professional success because he's the co-founder, the co-owner, the CEO of Walk-On Sports Bistro, which is a fast-growing restaurant. Drew Brees is a part owner. Do they have those in Florida yet? I know they're spreading throughout the Southeast.
I haven't seen one, at least not around my area, but that's not to say that they're not down here. I just haven't seen one around here yet. Hopefully soon.
Yes, they started in the Baton Rouge area, and that's kind of where, you know, things came out, where he was a walk-on. Him and another walk-on of the team were like, we eat at some great restaurants on the road, but not here at Baton Rouge. How can we make that happen here? So they're spreading. They have a really aggressive growth plan, actually sponsored a bowl game as well. But the thing that Brandon did was, when he wanted to walk onto the LSU team, he had to work up the nerve, right, to walk into the office, knock on the door and say, I'd like to try out for the team with a, you know, a first year coach. He's 18 years old. So that was him controlling his emotions, right? And so he's one of 60 kids for a tryout. This is back in 1997. When he gets cut, instead of getting emotional and saying, I got screwed over, this is ridiculous, I'll never make it, he went introspective and say, I've got to work harder, I got to play more, I got to get stronger, I've got to do the things that I need to do to make this team. So he went back to work. Well, a month later, he gets a call to be a practice player because some other guys had quit the team or got injured or something like that. All right. And so here's what happened. He said he was actually at home helping his dad, who's a sugarcane farmer. When he gets the call, he said he's like jumping up and down next to the tractor, like, I can't believe I'm going to be on the LSU team, even though it's just a practice player. They had a 6:30 a.m. practice the next day. He got there at 5:30. He said he was excited. He was excited, but he was scared to death because he's 5'11". He's going against 6'8" all Americans, right? And so he gets manhandled in the first practice. But again, he didn't cry. He said, what can I do to get better? He went to off-season workouts. He got stronger. He made the actual roster next year. He didn't get the name on his back of his jersey for several games, right? But they said it didn't matter. Your shooting shirt wasn't going to come off. The coach didn't even know his name. Instead of saying, he doesn't know my name, this is ridiculous, I'm not being treated like everybody else, he just developed a relentless attitude to be a walk-on there, and then also from a business standpoint. And so that's how they got the idea to start walk-ons. And so going back to his maximize his unique strength, he had this unique concept, but he also had the tenacity, right? And so he said, what can I do in order to start this business? He got turned down for one loan, for two, for three, all the way up to six banks until that seventh bank. And so I said to him, like, what would have happened if the seventh bank would have turned you down? He's like, I would have gone and I would have sought the eighth bank, right? And so he has that unique strength of that story, that experience. And now they have a unique culture at walk-ons where they say everybody from the CEO all the way to the dishwasher is an important part. And so he said it's everybody's contribution to make a team better. And he's brought that culture. He's brought that experience. He's brought that own unique concept that he came up with. He's really maximizing his unique strengths and saying, what can I do to get better? What can we do to get better? What can we do to be different?
And, you know, it's not always the shooter, right? It's not always the star. And you don't want to always duplicate your star player because everybody does have a different role. Somebody who came to mind when you're telling that story was Rodman, right? For the 90s
Dennis
Bulls.
Rodman.
Yeah, I'm an Illinois guy, right? So I had to be a Bulls fan back in the 90s when they were just, I mean, they were the New England Patriots of basketball for the 90s, right? So they were just slaughtering everybody. And if anybody remembers watching those games, or if you're a little bit younger and have to watch it on YouTube, whatever, but watch Rodman. He was horrible. He could not shoot, this guy, and he knew it. They knew it when they brought him on the team. He was not a shooter. You get him on the free throw line, it was almost as sad as watching Shaq, right? It was just...
probably worse, yeah.
You knew it was going to be a highlight reel, but not for the good reasons. But what he did bring to it was two things for me. Rebounding was obvious, right? The guy, nobody has ever rebounded like Rodman. He had a radius around him of like 12 feet where you couldn't get close to him because he spread his body out so much when he went up for that rebound. So he was a rebound king. But the other thing that I saw, even back then, I saw this, he was disruptive. He threw people off of their game. He played a really good, sometimes a little dirty mental game with people.
More than sometimes.
Right. I mean, he would just antagonize the crap out of you, but it brought you out of your mental game. It made you lose your concentration. So even the star players on the opposite team, they weren't as star of a player for that game because Rodman just totally threw them off. And that was one of his unique skills that he brought to that team that helped the scorers score more. You know, so it's not always the guy who gets all the headlines and everything that makes the biggest difference in some of those games. And I think it's the same, again, with business. You know, as in sports, as in life, business follows suit as well. But you don't have to be – every player of your team doesn't have to be the star player. Everybody's got their own unique skills that adds to the overall team. I mean, I know we're relating everything to a sports theme right now, but we're talking about teams as in, you know, business teams as well. The last step, step five of the walk-on method is make them throw you out of the gym. And I think I know what this one's about, but go into that a little bit.
Sure. And I'll just say first, if I can add your Dennis Rodman point, not that anybody has a copy of a Gannon media guide from back in the day when I played there, but it had in there, like, what's your favorite food, favorite player? I listed as my favorite player, Dennis Rodman, right? Because like you said, he just played his tail off. He was relentless.
He worked hard.
And like you said, he didn't get all the accolades. He didn't get the points. And so he was kind of my role model for diving into the stands and doing whatever it took, you know, getting floor burns. Those were better than scoring points.
I agree.
So it's funny that you say like, and I thought make them throw you out of the gym. And, you know, the tagline of that is never, ever, 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 ever quit. And so I thought it was intuitive. I thought it didn't need an explanation, but I had somebody who said to me, like, why would you want them to throw you out of the gym? Why are you making them do that? Like, you're supposed to cause trouble and they throw you out. I'm like, no. It's supposed to be make them throw you out. Don't throw yourself out of the gym. And so what we see a lot of times is folks from a career standpoint, from a business standpoint, from a life standpoint, they quit before anybody tells them you can't do this, right? Again, getting back to when I was at Gannon, you know, I walked onto the team, but when I would play at the rec center, when other, you know, other scholarship guys weren't there, I still wasn't the best guy on the floor, right? There were people who were more talented, stronger, taller. And then you think like, why didn't they try out for the team? And they had all sorts of reasons for why I probably wouldn't, they probably wouldn't keep me on. They probably didn't like this thing about me, but you've got to make sure that they throw you out of the gym, right? You've got to keep going and keep going. Even if they throw you out once, that you get back into it. And so the example of this is another person who's a business owner, Alan Williams. So he walked on at Wake Forest, played for coach Dave Odom. And he said his first year there, he was overwhelmed physically. He was actually a preferred walk-on. He had a pretty good high school career. They said, we're not going to give you a scholarship, but you can walk on. But then he's told at the end of his freshman year by coach Odom, you're not going to have a spot on the team next year because we need a big guy. So again, what could his reaction be? Like, I'm going to transfer. I guess it's not good for me. He kept showing up in the weight room and the track for cardio work and the gym. And so the coaches told him, dude, you're not on the team. Stop coming back for this, right? And then Coach Odom ends up taking the job at South Carolina, right? So what does Alan do? He's back in the weight room. He's back on the track. He's back doing all those workouts. Skip Prosser gets named the head coach. All right. And so Alan is invited to the first workout and he's like, good, I'm finally back on the team. And they're like, you're going to be the designated passer. All right. And so he was just like fodder there, not even really on the team. He gets called to the office and Coach Prosser tells him, and first he gets the call, he runs across campus and he says, so we're going to have a walk on the team, Alan, but we need somebody 6'6", 6'7". You're only 6'2". We need somebody to bang with the big guys. You're off the team again. And he's like, no, coach, the gym is where I want to be. And he said, like, I appreciate your persistence, but the answer is no. All right. So they have walk-on tryouts. They don't even tell him. The coaching staff doesn't inform him of walk-on tryouts. He sees a flyer on campus and he's like, guess what? He goes back into that gym for walk-on tryouts. He shows up there, 43 others, most of them taller. But what the coaches did was they saw his relentless effort and they said, you know what? It would be great to have a guy this hardworking on the team. So what he ended up doing was he made the team. And they kept him as a guard, and he ended up being a walk-on there for all 4 years. And so today, he continues that same attitude, and he's a co-president of a food products company. He also founded a leadership organization. He's a two-time author, and he's a motivational speaker. And so I asked him, like, why do you do all those things? Why can't you just do one of those things? And he said, once you establish a high commitment level, that never goes away. And so to me, that was a real lesson, I think, for all of us in terms of make sure you have that really high commitment level to getting a goal and keep coming back and keep being relentless in terms of whether it's that next sale, whether it's that market that you want to get into, whether it's a size of organization you want to be. Keep trying different things. Plan A might not work perfectly for you. Adapt, get better, and try plan B. But that's where it comes back to, like, they may, you know, Alan Williams made them throw him out of the gym. He never, ever quit. He got what he wanted for. And somebody told him, actually, a business owner told him while he was there, he said, being a walk-on is the hardest thing that you'll ever do. And he said that experience really trained him for the rigors of the business world.
Yeah, because you know that nobody wants you there and you have to try. You got to work harder than everybody else around you. And if you look at some of the top leaders in sports, again, you know, staying with the sports theme today, if you look at the top players, the top, you know, the guys that are going to be in the Hall of Fame, you know, the Bradys of the bunch, they're always the first one there. They're always the last one to leave. And it's the same in business. You know, if you have leadership in your company that, you know, they're always the first one in the office and they're always the last one to leave. You know, you don't want your entry-level employees unlocking the door, allowing themselves in and being there working for 45 minutes before the boss shows up. That's not showing them what kind of work ethic that you want. So if you're leading from the front, first one in the gym, you're working harder, you're pushing every day to make that next step, that, you know, keep raising that bar, people will follow. Jim, that is our time for today, man. Thank you so much for talking to us. Jim Roddy of the Walk On Method. Please tell everybody about the book, where they can get it, and how they can find you.
Sure. The book is available in paperback or ebook format, and it's available through Amazon. If you also want to keep track of things that go on with the book and other lessons, we're always uncovering new walk-ons and sharing success stories of the folks we profiled in the book. You can follow us. We have a Facebook page. You connect with me on LinkedIn. You can find me on Twitter. If you just do a quick search, Jim Roddy, Walk-On Method, in any one of those social media outlets, you'll be able to find me. If you want to reach out to me directly, and I'll offer this to your listeners, if you've message me on LinkedIn or email me directly at jim@jimroddycba.com. That's JIMRODDYCBA, like ABC backwards. It stands for coach and business advisor.com. Reach out to me. I'd be more than happy to share with you a free chapter from the book and our list of walk-on workplace do's and don'ts that really apply to your organization as a business owner. And the walk-on method has really proven to be a tool you can teach your teammates and you know, the folks who report to you, what are the aspects of career success, right? Like all the walk-on attitudes and behaviors we talked about before. As a business owner, imagine if you had a team that was full of that kind of walk-on behavior, of that, you know, servant leadership, of those folks who are taking a big shot, those folks who were relentless, right? Those folks who are maintaining emotional control. And the walk-on method can teach you that. And then also feel free to reach out to me and learn more about workshops that we offer to teams, able to do those via Zoom and be able to communicate with your team and give them takeaways, give them copies of the book that they can go and apply to their own career and to your organization. So again, yeah, Jim Roddy, jim@jimroddycba.com.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Jim, for taking time out of your morning this morning to talk with us. I appreciate it, and I look forward to reading the book myself soon.
Great. Thanks for having me, Craig.
Thank you for joining us this week. Go to our website at thebizreveal.com to catch all of our past episodes. We're available on all podcast apps, or you can watch any of our episodes on the Biz Reveal YouTube channel. I'm Craig Sawyer, and this is The Biz Reveal. Till next time.